Like many people, I've got several different kinds of cheap, inexpensive work lights that are mostly useful for casting a bit of light for a short period of time in hard to reach or hard to see areas. And this is a typical example. Pretty much every hardware store and grocery store and auto parts store, etc., would have a work light of this general sort. And they've got an array of bright white LEDs on them. And, you know, they can be pretty handy. This model's also got a sort of a flashlight, although there's no optics in there to really cast much of a beam. You know, they do cast some light, and they're generally useful, and they usually cost just a few dollars. However, I found myself more recently preferring this style, which typically cost about $5. And it's a very similar design overall, just like the other ones. It'll have a neodymium magnet on the back, so you can attach it to metallic objects, and a swiveling hanger, so you can hang it from various things. You know, both models have a sort of a flashlight function on them. This one's got 5 LEDs instead of 3. But the thing that really draws me to this model is that it's got this brighter type of LED strip in it, plus a real reflector that can aim the beam in a direction other than just random, like this other style has. Most work lights of this sort will take 3 AAA alkaline cells for their power source, and there's no provision for external power on them. So here's the flashlight function, and here's the work light function. Both of these have fresh batteries in them. You can see that the light given off by the style like this is just noticeably brighter and actually produces a useful beam for illuminating things, where this type is nowhere near as efficient in lighting up an area. So what's the problem with these? Well, they go through batteries like crazy. My project here is to try to figure out a way to make them work for longer periods of time without losing brightness and without going through loads of batteries. I haven't found that these work very well with rechargeables, mostly because the rechargeables are often a lower voltage than the alkalines. Of course, you can get different types, but even then, putting rechargeables in here, nickel metal hydride, for example, they go through them pretty quickly. They just use lots of power from the batteries. So I want to come up with a way to power these from AC so they can be left running for hours if necessary. So I'm going to dive into this thing here and take out the screws, open it up, and see what's going on inside. So what's inside of here is a battery holder that holds 3 AAA cells. You've got the flashlight assembly, which is just a circuit board with 5 LEDs wired in parallel. There is no resistor or any other component on this board. It's strictly the LEDs. And then when I flip the middle part of the case open, I've got the front of the case here, and here's the back of the reflector with the metal strip that has, I think it's acting as a heat sink. It's got the that yellow LED strip on it. I don't know how these are connected, but there's one wire connected at one end and one wire connected at the other end. I'm guessing that these multiple LEDs in here are going to be wired in parallel, because there's not going to be enough voltage from just three alkaline batteries to power a series connected string of LEDs. So I'm thinking they're all wired in parallel. Now as for the rest of the circuit, there is nothing else in here. It's just got the two LED assemblies, the battery holder, and this little switch. I'm going to check this out and see if there's anything inside the switch, like a hidden resistor or something, but I very much doubt it. So here are my multimeter continuity checker probes. Right now this is the battery feed coming from over here, so I'm going to check from the common to this one terminal, which goes to the flashlight. Nothing there. Going to the common terminal to the other tab, which goes to the Worklight LED. Nothing there. If I click the button once, it goes, I have these backwards, it goes first to this tab, which is for the flashlight. And even though it's not in the picture, my ohm meter says that's 0 ohms. There's no resistor there. If I push it again, there's nothing. It's open. If I push it again, now the other side of the switch is connected to the common, and it's also 0 ohms. Once again, there's no resistor internal to that switch. So, at first glance, one might think, well, I know that alkaline batteries are supposed to be about 1.5 volts per cell. So that gets me 4.5 volts for three of them. Therefore, this lamp ought to operate on 4.5 volts. So I'm going to go over here to my bench power supply, and I'm going to program it for 4.5 volts. And I'm going to hook it up to this thing and see if it runs. So I've got the power supply wired up across the battery terminals. I've got my power supply set here. I'm going to turn the power supply on. So I've got my 4.5 volts applied. Right now it's drawing 0 amps because the switch on the flashlight is turned off. I'm going to quick cycle it. And now I've got this coming out here. Now check this out. The voltage drops below 4 volts and it's pulling half an amp. But half an amp is an awful lot to be pulling from AAA batteries. I've got a little water on the back of my screwdriver here. I don't know if you can see that, but it's boiling it right off the back. You can see the steam coming off here and condensing on the... I actually had another one of these that I took apart, which is not included in this video, and the LED heatsink here got so hot that it just melted the plastic reflector and fell completely off. This one isn't getting quite that hot, but even holding it here, I can feel a lot of heat coming off that it's very noticeably hot, like an IC that's burning up. So this is not a good situation. Yeah, that's definitely too hot to hold. Not a good situation for continued use. So now I've got the batteries put back in. Fresh set of batteries. And I've got my voltmeter wired up across the batteries. And they're reading 4.6, almost 4.7 volts right now. As soon as I turn the switch on, let's see what happens to the battery voltage. Draws it down to about 3.6 volts. Alright, so the next experiment is, I've still got the batteries in here. I've got this meter connected up across the batteries, showing 4.6 volts. I've got this meter up here, set for DC volts and wired across the LED. And right now it's just showing some very low voltage floating around there. It's in the millivolts. And then I've got this meter set up as a milliampere meter. It's good for up to 500 milliamps. And it's wired across the switch. So it'll be in series with the battery and the LED as soon as I connect it here. So the LED is on. My battery voltage has dropped to 4.3 volts. I've got 2.9 basically on the LED, and I'm drawing about between 270 and 290 milliamps. Now the difference here is that I can put my finger on the heat sink of this LED, and it's quite warm. I would say almost hot, but it's just at the point where I can keep my finger on it without getting burned, although it's definitely uncomfortable. Now here's a second experiment. In this case, I wired directly onto the ends of the LED assembly instead of hooking up to different convenient points in the lamp circuit that I presume to be the same points electrically. And I've also got clipped directly across the battery, not through any wiring. So, right now, my battery voltage is almost 3.5 volts, while my LED voltage is sitting here at 3 volts. That means about half a volt is being dropped somewhere besides the LED. It can only be dropped in the wiring. And just now I put a third volt meter across the switch here and verified that there's essentially no drop there. This particular meter is very sensitive and it'll pick up just electrical field in the air, and it's always got a little bit of activity on it, but there's nothing substantial being dropped across the switch. So everything's being dropped, that extra half volt is being dropped in the wiring of the lamp assembly. So my revised schematic for this lamp has the three AAA batteries, or three AAA cells rather, here, which is a nominal 4.5. It might be 4.6 with no load. It's obviously got some sort of internal resistance, as we know batteries do. There's a circuit including the power switch and the return wiring to the battery, and that's got some resistance. We know it's dropping between 0.5 and 0.6 volts. And I've got a measured 3.1 thereabouts volts across the LED assembly. Now I'd previously measured about 350 milliamps there, but that of course is with the milliampere meter in the circuit, which is otherwise not depicted here, so I don't consider that to be a totally reliable figure, because that adds the additional resistance of the milliampere meter into the circuit. When I was powering the assembly off of my bench power supply, as you recall, it was pulling the voltage down to, I forget what it was now, it was about a volt, I think, lower than it should have been. I think it was pulling it down below 4 volts. It might have been down to 3.5. somewhere between 3.5 and 4 volts anyway, and it was pulling a full 500 milliamps, which I think is the maximum output of this supply, and I don't have the specifications here and it's not on the front, but that sounds like, since it's a nice round number, I think that's its maximum output, which is why its output was dropping. It was unable to supply 4.5 volts at the full 500 milliamp output, so it was sagging the voltage. Obviously, a large part of this lamp's circuit functionality is based on the idea that you've got inherent voltage drops here. The LED is always going to want to have about the same voltage across it, and I was generally measuring pretty close to 3 volts, 2.9, 3, 3.1, anywhere in that area. So I'm thinking that this LED assembly's nominal forward voltage is about 3 volts, and it's going to want to keep it at that. At the same time, the battery, these AAA batteries, I don't think they're capable of putting out 500 milliamps like the power supply could, and so you're going to drop some voltage across its internal voltage, and its output will sag, and we know that under load it's about 3.6 volts. But it is able to operate the LEDs at 3.6 volts. Now if I let it keep running, it's going to go to a lower and lower voltage, but when the batteries are fresh, they're giving me about 3.6 volts. And I know that I'm losing about 0.6 volts in the wiring itself. Now that's an awful lot of loss. Now these are really small gauge wires, but there's only a few inches of them, and that seems like a lot of voltage drop, even for a small gauge wire. Without doing the math, I'm wondering if these wires are normal copper wires, or if maybe one or more of these wires is actually resistance wire. I wouldn't put it past the manufacturer to have used at least one length of that in here, and it could be any one of these lengths. Okay, this is the third test rig I've got. Once again, trying to get a more accurate read on this. I've got a 1 ohm, 1% resistor. Immediately in series with the plus terminal of the battery going to the switch. I'm measuring the voltage across it with this guy here. I'm measuring the LED voltage directly across the LED with this guy. And I'm measuring the battery voltage with this guy. Now the battery's already sagged a little bit. It's, even with the light off, it's only down to 4.3 volts. Just because I've been messing with it a little bit, but still I'm going to go ahead and fire it up here and see what the readings are. Okay, we've got this. I'm still pulling about 3.9 on the battery voltage. I've still got about 3 volts on the LED voltage, just trying to keep it there. And I've got roughly 0.6 volts on the 1 ohm resistor, which means 600 milliamps are going through that. 0.6 volts divided by 1 ohm should be 600 milliamps. So back to my circuit schematic here. I've got my nominal 4.5 volt battery, which under load puts out 3.9 volts measured at its terminals. It's got some internal resistance. I don't know exactly what the voltage across that is. I've added a 1 ohm resistor in series with the plus terminal of the battery. I'm measuring 0.6 volts drop across it. I'm still measuring 3 volts approximately across the LED, which means I have to be dropping 0.3 volts across the wiring in the circuit in order to add up to the 3.9 volts measured on the battery. Now, when I didn't have this measurement diode or measurement resistor up here, I was measuring, or I was presuming to have a 0.6 volt drop, because at that time the measured voltage on the battery and the measured voltage on the LED were 0.6 volts different, so there had to be 0.6 volts dropped in the wiring. Now with the added 1 ohm resistor here, which I was using to measure the voltage drop and thereby get some idea of the current in the circuit, the voltage drop in the wiring had to have gone down to a point, down to about 0.3 volts. You know, obviously the dynamics of this circuit are such that the LED is trying to maintain its 3 volts, the battery is sagging in its voltage and its ability to put out current as time goes on, as I'm measuring the circuit. So the numbers are always changing a little bit, but it's pretty clear that the current in the circuit is somewhere in the ballpark of 600 milliamps. The LED wants to have 3 volts across it. Those are the two most important numbers if I'm going to power this circuit by some other means. I need to make sure the LED can have 3 volts, and I need to make sure that I've got 600 milliamps if I'm going to have the desired brightness of the LED. So now, looking at the classic LED circuit with some DC voltage across the circuit, some series resistance, and an LED or an LED array, I know from my previous experiments that this circuit with 3 AAA batteries wants to pull approximately 600 milliamps through it, and it's going to try to maintain about 3 volts across the LED. So whatever extra voltage is coming from my power supply has to be dropped either through the wiring or through a series resistance. In this circuit diagram, all of that's rolled up into one resistor. So this is any wiring drops and any actual resistors I may put in there. If this voltage is constant and I want to keep 3 volts here and 600 milliamps here, the only thing I can adjust is this resistance to get the desired current through this LED. So what I've done here is I've wired up my lamp again. I've still got this meter telling me the actual voltage across the LED, this meter telling me the actual measured voltage across the battery terminals, and this meter telling me the measured voltage across a 1 ohm resistor, therefore giving me the circuit current in milliamps. And I've got this power supply here, which is capable of a 1 amp output, unlike my other supply that could only do 500 milliamps. This one can do up to 1 amp. I've currently got it current limited to 600 milliamps, even though that doesn't show right now. It's wired directly across the battery terminals. So if I turn the lamp on, I can see here that I'm limiting to 0.6 amps, and I'm putting out about 4.3 volts right now. I'm measuring the desired 2.9, close to 3 volts across the LED. I'm only getting 3.8 volts measured across the battery, even though the power supply says it's putting out 4.3 volts. Am I really dropping about half a volt in the power supply wiring? It would seem so. I've still got the desired 600 milliamps, in other words, a 0.6 volt drop across a 1 ohm resistor. That's this guy down here. So I'm measuring about 600 milliamps in the circuit, and the lamp is about the brightness I would expect. Touching it here, it's pretty darn hot. It seems like it's hotter than it was with the batteries, and I don't know why that is, because with the same current through it and the same voltage, it should have the same amount of heat coming off of it, but it's obviously hotter here. I can't hold my thumb on it, which I could do when it was running off the batteries. And I don't really understand the reason for that difference. So let me try current limiting this guy down to about 500 milliamps, and I'm measuring pretty close to that up here. See if that makes any difference. I still have pretty good brightness coming out of this. I want to see if it cools down any. Yeah, it's just, you can't even hold your finger on there. It's sizzling hot. Taking a step back, here is the classic LED circuit. If you're using your normal little red LEDs, like, you know, are found on practically every piece of equipment, the cheap and dirty rule of thumb method for calculating those is to assume that those standard LEDs had a voltage drop of about 1.6 volts. They wanted to keep 1.6 volts across them. It's almost like a Zener effect. And a classic circuit might have 5 volts on it. That was your old TTL voltage. So let's say you had a power supply of 5 volts. You know your LED is going to drop 1.6 volts. And you had a series resistor to limit the current. So you know you had to have 3.4 volts across the resistor, because that's what's left after you take 1.6 from 5. We had a nominal 10 milliamps, which is what those old LEDs wanted to have for full brightness. So I take my 3.4 volts and divide it by 10 milliamps, and I get 340 ohms. So a 340 ohm resistor on a 5 volt circuit with a 1.6 volt LED would give me 10 milliamps through the circuit, which is what the LED wanted for nominal brightness. If we go back into the circuit I'm working with here, let's say I had a 5 volt power supply on there. I know this LED wants to have 3 volts, and operating it from a battery gives me 600 milliamps approximately in the circuit. So I'm going to take my 3 volts, subtract it from my 5, and I would get 2 volts that has to be dropped somewhere. I'm going to presume this is in a resistor. The 2 volts divided by the 600 milliamps gives me a 3.3 ohm resistor. So if this is all correct, and I take a 5 volt power supply capable of more than 600 milliamps, so the power supply is not limiting the current, and I put a 3.3 ohm resistor in there, I should get the 600 milliamps. Now, that's all well and good, but what kind of resistor would I put in here? The wattage for the resistor is going to be the voltage drop times the current through it. So 600 milliamps is going to be 0.6 amps times 2 volts, and that's 1.2 watts. Certainly more than my little quarter watt resistors are going to give me. So if I wanted to try this out in my lab, I could rig up some sort of a 1.2 watt resistor with a value of 3.3 ohms and set my power supply up for 5 volts, make sure it's set to not limit the current to 600 milliamps, and then measure it and see if I actually do have 600 milliamps, still have 3 volts across my LED like it would have in the battery version of the circuit. And if that was the case, then I could order some appropriate power resistors and maybe a switching power supply, a wall wart or something, capable of an amp perhaps, and with a 5 volt regulated output, and I might make this work. So how am I going to make a 3.3 ohm resistor of 1.2 watts or better? Well, the first way to approach this, since I'm just fooling around here, would be to divide 1.2 watts by a quarter watt, since I've got a bunch of quarter watt resistors, and that comes out to be about 5. So 5 quarter watt resistors in parallel or in series would allow me to divvy the wattage up between those 5 resistors. But then I did the math to try to see what resistors I had laying around, and it turned out I happened to have 3 22 ohm resistors and 3 18 ohm resistors. And it so happens if you put those all in parallel, you get just about exactly 3.3 ohms. How is this figured out? Since we're just doing this for fun here, the parallel resistance is done by reciprocals. So to calculate out these parallel resistances, just to check that I'm going to get the right value, I'm going to put in 18 ohms, take the reciprocal of it, multiply that times 3, and I'm going to stick the result in memory location 1 and clear out. Then I'm going to take 22 ohms, take the reciprocal of it, multiply by 3, and then add that to what's in memory location 1, get the total, and take the reciprocal of that and I get 3.3 ohms, which is exactly what I was trying to get here. So my three 22 ohm resistors and three 18 ohm resistors should come out to be the exact 3.3 ohms that I calculated. And since they're quarter watt values each, the entire resistor should come out to be 6 × 1/4 or 1.5 watts, which is more than the calculated 1.2 watts I thought I would need. Okay, so now I've taken my previous test circuit with the power supply here set to its full available 1 amp, so it won't be limiting, and I've got the power supply set to 5 volts, and I'm monitoring at 5 volts, so that's accurate. Right now there's essentially no voltage drop across my 1 ohm resistor, so there's basically no current in the loop, and the measured voltage across the LED is just whatever the leads are picking up from the electrical field in the room here. So I'm going to engage this circuit and see what's going on here. I'm getting a little bit low on the LED voltage. I'm measuring a milliamp rating of only about 370 milliamps or 370 millivolts across a 1 ohm resistor, so 370 milliamps. My power supply is dropping down to 3.3 volts, even though the power supply itself is putting out 5. It seems to be suggesting that I'm dropping about 1.7 volts in my wiring. I don't understand why it's doing that. But that could be that, that's actually what's being dropped across the resistors. That's where it's being dropped, which is, what did I say it was? It was 5 volts minus 3.7. So, you know, 1.7 volts. I'd calculated a 2-volt drop. Alright, so the voltage I'm getting after the resistors is 3.4 volts, which means since the power supply is putting out 5 volts, that I must be dropping 1.6 volts across my resistors here. I'd hope to be dropping 2 volts there. But regardless, I'm still getting just about 3 volts across the LED. So the calculations aren't working out correctly here. I mean, they're in the ballpark, but they're not quite correct, which means there's a lot of dynamics here. First off, there's a lot of current flowing in this circuit, and the wires are fairly fine. You can even feel warmth in the resistors in the lamp assembly. Secondly, this lamp assembly was never intended to be powered off of a power supply that can deliver meaningful amounts of current. It's supposed to be powered off a set of batteries that are very self-limiting because they just aren't really designed to put out that much current at their rated voltage. So the whole design seems to be based on a totally simple and inexpensive approach that doesn't require any current limiting, any voltage regulation, anything that costs money. Instead, they may have some resistance wire, or perhaps it's just regular copper wire, but very fine gauge, so it ends up having a fair amount of resistance. And they just let the thing sit there and cook, really. I'm going to do a quick... Okay, right now, with both the power supply, 370 milliamps, and my resistor measuring says 368 milliamps, so basically the same reading, pretty close. which is far from the 600 milliamps I thought this should have. Why the difference? Well, obviously, this simple circuit, which works well with regular red and, you know, green LEDs that have been around forever, doesn't completely apply with these very bright, high-intensity LED strips. And also, when they're in a circuit with so many cheesy things like these super small gauge wires that have a fair amount of resistance, the dynamics are shifting around and it makes it hard to calculate something that'll give you the desired result right off the bat. Could probably do this empirically. In my quest to get a bit more current through this circuit, I've added two more 18-ohm resistors for a total of 5 against the 3 22-ohm resistors. That calculates out to 2.4 ohms, and here they are. So I'm going to check my power supply, verify that I've still got it up there, turn the lamp on, and what have I got here? I've got just about 2.9 volts on the LED, but the current is still way low. It's about 390 milliamps here. So I haven't succeeded in boosting it very much. I've noted the current in the circuit is crawling up as the LED warms up. It says it's about 450 milliamps now, which is in the ballpark of what I'm measuring up here. So it's getting a bit closer to where I wanted it to be. The LED is pretty warm. It's in the area of what I was measuring with just the battery. It's unpleasantly warm, but it's not so hot I can't keep my thumb on it. So it's getting there. Not sure about the light output. It seems a little bit dim. But at least the voltage on the LED is about right. I'd like it to be closer to 3 volts. If I had a resistor decade box, it would go down into the low ohms. I'd be all set. But since I don't, I'm stuck doing this painstaking experiment with adding parallel resistors. So I've added 2 more 18-ohm resistors since I've got them laying around. That's up to 7 of those, plus the 3 22-ohm resistors. That comes out to 1.9 ohms. And here they are. So, once again, verify the power supply. Everything looks good there. Kick it on. I'm up to 460 milliamps cold. And it's climbing as the LED warms up. I'm up to my 2.9 volts on the LED, which is about where I want it to be. So let's let this thing cook for a little while. And see where it gets. Climbing up here, still going up. Getting up around 470 milliamps. The power supply says it's 480 milliamps. That's probably due to an error in my 1-ohm resistor. It's probably not really 1 ohm. I'm kind of inclined to believe this a bit more. It says I'm pretty close to 490 milliamps. And it still seems to be slowly climbing up. Give it a little bit longer. Wonder what the temperature is like on this. Still tolerable, but it's almost to the point where I feel like I'm getting burned on the back of this guy here. This is crawling up to 480 now. And the power supply says it's putting out 0.5 amp. So we're getting really close to what I had before here, and still having a reasonably tolerable temperature on the back of this LED. Now what might be fun to do is glue on a little piece of aluminum there to get some more heat sinking and bump it up even more. Wonder how my resistors here are doing. They're all doing very nicely. Nothing's getting too hot. But as the LED sits there and cooks, the current is slowly going up. My voltmeter's gone to sleep, but it's still measuring, you know, in the ballpark of 2.9. It goes up and down a little bit. Measuring 3.6 volts at the battery terminals after the voltage drop. So I've still got 5 volts coming out of the supply. 3.6 there, so I've got 1.4 volts being dropped across the resistors. And maybe some in the wiring as well. But this would all be external wiring since I'm measuring at the battery terminals. So that's just in the power supply wires in my test leads, which is a lot of drops, so I think almost all of it's in these resistors. But they're not too hot. I've divvied the wattage up quite a bit, so they're not more than just very slightly warm. But now I can't hold my thumb on this. It's gone up to just about an even 0.5 amp here, measured, and it's up to 0.52 amps here. This makes me think that what I really want to do is limit the current on this to probably about 500 milliamps, not let it get any more than that, and beef up the heatsink on here in some inexpensive way. The resistors by themselves don't completely limit the current here because they're passive devices. What I'd really like to do is have something more like the current limiting circuit on this power supply that would limit me to 500 milliamps period, no matter what else changes. So I'm going to investigate making a small current limiting circuit, maybe using a voltage regulator chip, and see what happens with that. So the next step is to try to find out some way to keep the current through the LED constant without all the other variables. So the obvious approach to this is to use a constant current source or a constant current regulator. I want to do it on the cheap. I want to do it simply. So it occurs to me to use an LM317, which is normally considered to be a adjustable positive voltage regulator IC. I'm going to talk a little bit about my thoughts on how to do this. So this is the schematic for a normal LM317 voltage regulator with your positive and negative terminals of your input voltage and your load voltage here, which is what you're regulating. You got the 317 here, it's input terminal, it's output terminal, it's adjust terminal. And even though what's inside of here is an IC with quite a few parts, for our purposes, you can think of it as being a variable resistor between the input and the output. In reality, it's some sort of transistor or group of transistors, but it all acts like a variable resistor. And the LM317 wants to see a voltage of 1.25 volts between its output pin and its adjust pin at all times. If it doesn't get 1.25 volts, it adjusts the value of this resistor until it gets it. And normally what you have here is a voltage divider, so you take your output voltage and you run it through this voltage divider, and if the output voltage is correct, you'll be dropping 1.25 volts across this resistor, so the chip will be happy and it'll sit there. If the output voltage changes in the wrong way, it might increase this resistor, it might decrease this resistor, whatever's required to get this back to 1.25 volts. That's all it wants to see. Now, if I configure it like this, without any reference to the ground or negative terminal here, I just have this series resistor coming out of the output pin, and I go to my load and I tie the other side of the resistor back to the adjust. Now it's going to have some current going through here to the load, and if the current is too high or too low, we always have a voltage drop across this resistor. And if the current is higher, it'll be a greater voltage drop. If the current is less, it'll be a lesser voltage drop. And since that resistor is connected between the out and the adjust, the LM317 is looking at that voltage, and it's going to try to adjust this series resistor until it gets 1.25 volts across this resistor. So in that way, it behaves as a variable resistance in the circuit, dedicating itself to adjusting that resistance until you get the desired current. So from my previous experiments, I decided I wanted to keep about 500 milliamps going in this circuit, and therefore the resistor value I have here is going to be 1.25 volts divided by the current through it, and that's going to give me the resistor, which would be 2.5 ohms. So now I know the component values here, and the other couple of considerations about this, although I've never built a constant current source using a 317 before, I know that I have to worry about the wattage on this resistor. So that's going to be 1.25 volts times 500 milliamps, which is, something like 0.6 watts thereabouts. I'm just going to say I'm going to try to get it somewhere between half a watt and 1 watt for that resistor. And the other thing is that you have to consider your voltage input. Now, the voltage input could probably vary quite a bit here, because all that's going to happen is this resistor is going to change by quite a large margin to get this 1.25 volts here. And depending on what the load's doing, depending on your input voltage, this resistor could be quite a large number of different values. What we don't want to do is drop a lot of voltage across this, because at 500 milliamps going through here, if there's a lot of voltage here, then I'm going to have a lot of power dissipated right here, which is going to make this 317 get pretty hot. I want to minimize that. At the same time, I know that this IC requires, I forget what it is, it's somewhere between, 1.5, 2, 3 volts, something like that, that it really needs to operate properly. So whatever my voltage out here is going to be, I'm going to have to add 1.25 volts dropped across this resistor, add whatever minimum operating voltage the 317 needs, and that'll be my minimum voltage that I have out here, and I'm going to want to stay pretty close to that so I don't make this part unnecessarily warm. So in my previous resistor array that I'd made up here for the other test, I had 3 22-ohm resistors and 7 18-ohm resistors wired in parallel. I just did a calculation. If I cut the 22-ohm resistors out and just leave the 7 18-ohm resistors, that works out to be almost exactly 2.5 ohms, which is what I calculated I needed here for the LM317. So I'm just going to reuse this resistor array here and clip out the 3 22-ohm resistors and see how that works. Okay, so now I've got those 3 22 resistors clipped out here in the middle, and I've got the remaining network connected between the output terminal, which is the middle terminal of the 317, and the adjust terminal, which is the left-hand terminal. The input terminal is the remaining one there, so now I have to connect that up. Okay, I've got the LM317 wired in here. It's wired in between the plus lead of the power supply and the plus terminal of the battery on the lamp assembly. I still have my 1-ohm resistor in here monitoring current through the circuit, and I still have my meter over here measuring the voltage directly across the LED. But this other meter up here is now measuring the voltage across this, so I can see if it's what I'm hoping it is. So I've got a calculation done here. I said I want 3 volts on the LED plus 1.25 volts plus, say, a couple of volts across the LM317, and I've currently set my bench supply for 6.5 volts, and the current is set for no current regulation, so it'll put out up to 1 amp. I'm going to live dangerously here and not limit it at the power supply. I'm going to monitor it on my meter. If it goes way out of whack, I'm going to shut it off right away. So let's see what happens here. Power supply is on. Okay. My LED is on. I've got about 2.9 volts on the LED. I'm only measuring 0.8 volts across that resistor, but I am measuring about 344 milliamps. So that suggests to me that I might be dropping too much in the regulator. Let's see. The regulator is slightly warm at this point. I may be starving it a little bit. Let me try going up to about 7.5 volts here and see what happens. So now I'm getting just about the 3 volts on the LED. My current is up closer to 500 milliamps. I'm getting the requisite 1.25 volts approximately on the adjust pin of the 317. And I'm getting a pretty good brightness out here. About like what I saw before, I think. I'm wondering what my 317 is doing here. It's pretty hot. It's going to need a heat sink. I can still hold it, but it's a little on the warm side. The LED here feels about like what it was before. Quite hot, but not so hot I can't keep my finger on it. So we're in the ballpark here. I think this circuit is functioning, and I'm going to do this very briefly so I don't damage the 317 or cause it to go into thermal shutdown. But if I knock this guy up to about 9 volts here, my current has not changed at all. And I'm going to keep it on the meter while I lower it back down to 7 volts. And you can see it really didn't change substantially. But it really sags if I get down below 6.5 volts. So in order to function, there it's regulating about 476 milliamps. And in order to get that, it starts dropping here right around 6.9, so it needs to have at least 7 volts coming in order for the regulator to function properly. So I'm gonna try for 9 volts, since that's a standard power supply input. I'm sitting here, I've got my 1.25 volts, I've got my pretty close to 500 milliamps. I think the reason it's not 500 milliamps is because my resistor values aren't exactly right. But I'm pretty close to my 2.9 volts here. So I think this is pretty much ideal. I'm mostly just worried about whether anything gets too hot here. This is pretty darn warm at this point. And that is too hot to hold. So there's a issue there. It'd be nice if I could run this thing without a heat sink. Okay, so is this a wild goose chase? Am I on the wrong path? I do have my current regulated. It's now insensitive to other variables in the circuit. It's going to give me my desired current. It's going to be consistent regardless of other variables. I'm pretty sure the circuit is stable. So that's workable from a circuit standpoint, but I have to get rid of that heat. I've got more heat than I would like on the LED. I don't know why that is, why it's running hotter than it seems to with the batteries, although probably it's still okay. It's not hot enough to melt plastic or anything, and I think the thing that saves this in reality is that when you first turn it on with a fresh set of batteries, it does get pretty darn hot. But in very short order, you know, within 30 seconds or a minute or something, the batteries are already dropping so much because there's so much load on them that immediately the current drops way back off and you get a drop in brightness that you may not perceive right away. And then it'll sit there for a while as the batteries slowly decay and lose capacity. So I think that's sort of built into the design. The problem here is that I'm giving it a power supply that does not sag. It keeps that current going, and that is going to be a bit too much. So what do I do about that? Well, one thing I can do is change my resistors and take it down a little bit from 500 milliamps, say 400 milliamps, and say, you know, it's not optimum brightness, but at least it's not going to bake itself. Or I can keep it at 500 milliamps and put a heatsink on it and try to keep it a little bit cooler. So I think I might experiment with that. Inside the case here, the LED normally goes kind of in this position with the back of it right up close to this piece of plastic here. I don't know, it's, you know, maybe a eighth of an inch or so away from it. And there's no air circulation in here, so whatever heat it has to be gotten rid of within this case. And that's a problem when you have excess heat. There's just no ventilation. But what I can do is maybe heat sink it a little bit. I can try super gluing a piece of aluminum foil or something onto the back and just see if I can get some of the heat away from it and see if that helps. I've decided to do one more sanity check. I've put a fresh set of AAAs in here, wired up just like it would be from the factory, except for my 1 ohm resistor I'm using for current monitoring. And I'm going to turn this on very briefly and just double check what it says my current in the circuit is. So it's setting up around 380 millivolts here, which is 380 milliamps through the circuit. And this is with the flashlight going. But if I turn on the main lamp, it's going up around 680 millivolts, which is 680 milliamps. Way more than I was giving it with the other power supply. I'm just going to see how hot this guy gets. And I do have my same voltage as I was getting before, 2.9 on the LED. And I can't hardly hold my finger on this anymore. It's just getting too hot. Six hundred eighty-seven milliamps. Yeah, it's too hot to touch now, really. I do note that my current is dropping a little bit here. It's down to 680. 679. 6, 78, 7. This is because the batteries are depleting already, or some characteristic of the LED is such that its internal resistance is going up and cutting down the current. Yeah, that's piping hot there. But already I'm dropping down to 666. So it's way down from the initial value. And keep in mind that the current would probably be even higher if I didn't have this 1-ohm resistor in here, which is having a substantial effect. The impedances in this circuit generally being so low, I think it would be even hotter if I had taken this out, which I would in a working circuit. Yeah, you can't really even touch this. It's piping hot. And this is an unadulterated circuit. The only thing that's different here from the factory is the addition of this 1-ohm resistor in the circuit. Already down to 630, about 3 minutes and 45 seconds into this test. So I'm going to let it go for a little bit here. I'm going to leave the camera running, but I'll probably edit some of this out. I just want to see over time. I'm using the camera as my stopwatch. And see how far it drops down, if it gets down around 500 milliamps. Okay, so here at about 6.5 minutes, it's down to 566 milliamps. And this is still too hot to keep my finger on, but this is all natural. Apparently it's designed to run that way. Give it some more time. Okay, so the lamp has been on for 10 minutes and 30 seconds with a fresh set of AAA cells, and it's down to 500 milliamps in the circuit. It's about what I'd calculated I wanted to run it at with my power supply. I can't hold my hand on the back of this, but I'm going to conclude from this that this lamp is designed to have that kind of heat on it, and I'm not going to have to heat sink it. It should be safe to operate this way, so no heat sink on that. I could probably glue something on, but then I would lose, through the glue, some thermal conductivity to my heat sink, and it might actually make things worse. I don't have anything to increase the size of this heat sink without compromising it at the same time, so it's just going to have to be what it is. So the only thing remaining, if I'm going to use my current limiting LM317, is a way to get rid of the heat on the 317 itself. Alright, so what I need to do next is get a power supply and some LM317s. I usually buy my parts from DigiKey. I liked in these projects to keep things very generic, so anybody following them can easily get the same parts. If I'm using hardware, I try to go with hardware store parts and so on. And unfortunately, when it comes to electronics, it's hard to be that generic about it. But I am going to stick with a very non-specialty place here. DigiKey is one of the best places in the country to buy parts for hobbyists and home experimenters. And they have the largest stock. I also like places like Mauser and Jameco and JDR, micro devices and so on for parts, but right now I'm going to use DigiKey for this. The first thing I'm going to do is go to their website, which is digikey.com, And I'm going to go down to, let's see if I can narrow it down a little bit. Electronic components. Power supplies, external off board. And I'm going to go with wall adapters, 7,331 of these guys. So I'm going to have to use some filters. Now, most of the time when I need a wall wart these days, I use CUI. They just have a really nice high quality series, so I'm going to start with them and I'm going to apply this filter. I'm in North America, but I'm not going to select anything there. I do want a wall mount, so I'm going to apply that filter. I actually don't need to apply it every time, I'm just going to select these guys. I want a fixed blade type, just a normal wall wart. I'd like it to be universal voltage, so you know, somewhere in the 900 or 90 to 265 volts, but I'm not going to select it. But I am going to select my 9 volts. As you recall, I figured that with that LM317, I needed over 7.5 volts anyway to operate it adequately. The power supplies tend to have a big gap. After 6 volts, they go to 9, so I'm going to have to live with 9 volts. Now my output current, I'm running this thing at 500 milliamps, but I'm not going to select it. It's going to be really specific if I do. Unfortunately, they don't let me select, like, you know, at least this much current. If I put in, you know, 600 milliamps for it to be safe, for example, it's only going to show me those with a rated 600 milliamp output. I don't want to do that. So I'm going to go over here and see what other criteria there are. I think I'm going to say positive center. That'll give me a wall wart with a connector on it. But actually, I don't think I'm going to even use a plug on these. I'm probably just going to direct wire them in. So I'm not actually going to use that. I'm not going to specify it. If it comes with a plug, I'm just going to cut it off. Efficiency, operating temperature, blah, 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 blah. I don't care. I don't want to be too specific with that. I'm not worried about the size. So the main things I've selected are a fixed blade wall wart with a 9 volt output. And I'm just going to apply these filters and see what I get. Here's a CUI 9 volt. It's good for 1.2 amp. That's probably a little bit too much. Let me scroll down here and see something. I'd like to get it a bit more than that, just so it's not running near its maximum. But it seems like these guys are all jumping from 600 milliamps up to 1.2 amps. So that's okay. I can go with 1.2 amps. It's an overkill. And the other thing I want to do is find something that's in stock and not too expensive. All these guys here are going to be in the, you know, $9 to $13 range, it looks like. And the ones that are 670 milliamps are going to be, well, you know, these are rated for 670 milliamps, and I'm limiting my current to 500, so these are safe. There's no reason to go overkill on these, really. Save myself a little bit of money. I also want to find stock. There's a lot of non-stock parts here. Or they'll say they've got, you know, well, this is a minimum quantity. So I don't want to pick any of these guys that are non-stock, and most of these are. So going back, what do I have in 670 milliamps that's not a non-stock item? Here is this guy here. It's 670 milliamps, 9 volts, universal voltage, fixed blade, wall mount. They're about $10.50 each. DigiKey has 89 in stock for immediate shipment. And that's probably going to be my guy. Seems like the only one that's got the right combination of things, and that's a SWI6-9-N-P7. That's the DigiKey part number. And, that's the manufacturer part number. DigiKey's part number is 102-3614-ND. I think everything they have says ND on the end. That's just the way they know that it's a DigiKey part instead of somebody else's part. So let's go here and select this guy. Here's what it looks like. And 89 in stock, can ship immediately. Unit price is $10.51. There's a small price break if I order five. I actually have four such lamps. I'm going to order four of these guys and modify all four. No point messing around with this. Just go for the gusto. So I'm not going to show the part here where I order it, but that's a part that would probably work well with this project if you were to try to duplicate it yourself. Okay, so the next thing to get is some LM317s. I have some in my junk box, but I want to use some new ones for this. So, LM317. Integrated circuit. Voltage regulator. I don't really care which brand I use, but I don't want all these goofy things here. Alright, anyway, so for the LM317, I was just checking the Texas Instruments LM317 data sheet and verifying which version of it I want. So I'm going back here and I'm just going to select Texas Instruments. I'm not going to worry about the packaging yet. These other things are nonsensical to select at this point. The LM317s are 1.5 amp parts. I'm not going to select anything there. I'll get the right thing. The voltages, again, come with the part. I don't know why they even have that selected here. Now there is a LM317A, which is an industrial part, and it can tolerate much colder operating temperatures. That'd be the minus 40 degrees C on the low end. The normal run-of-the-mill part that most people are going to use is the one that's rated from 0 degrees C up to 125 operating temperature. If you know, this is freezing here, so if you think you're going to be operating your lamp in some place that's colder than freezing, you might want to go with this other part, but I'm just going to select this. It's going to be probably more readily available. And I'm going to select the TO220. That's your normal package like I showed before. And I think the dash 3 just means it's the TO220 with three pins on it. So I'm going to go back here and apply the filters and see what I end up getting. LM317T from Texas Instruments. There's about a zillion and one of these things available. 7,410 of them at DigiKey. And let's just see if that's in any way other than what I want. Now here's, I don't know what this NOPB thing is. This green arrow means it's Rojas, which I don't especially like. And this one means it's not. This is your run-of-the-mill LM317T here. So that's not Rojas. There's a lot of them available. Let's see what it looks like. 1.5 amps. Through hole to TO223. I'm liking this part, so I'm going to go to this, and everything looks good. It's just your basic LM317T, just like the one I had with the ND, meaning it's DigiKey's part. LM317T is the manufacturer's part. They're $1.75. Can't do much better than that, I think. I'm going to go ahead and order, I need a few more in my junk box, so I'm going to just order 10 right now. But you can order whatever you want. Okay, at least on DigiKey, I wasn't able to find any 2.5 ohm resistors in a single resistor pack that met the requirements. So, just going to go back here and go with the discrete solution. Pretty much like I had it in the test. Through-hole resistors. Now, I'd actually done a previous check here, and Panasonic apparently is getting out of the business. I always used to like their discrete resistors, and it seems like one of the companies that's really taking over on that is Stackpole. But I've also had good luck with Yago. You could go either way. I'm going to go with Stackpole here because they're a very well-established brand. And again, I don't care about the series, but I do need a I need 18 ohms. Going at it the wrong way here. Overshooting. It's so touchy, I can't drag the pointer to it. 18 ohms. And I'm going to go with a 1%. Tolerance, that's plenty good. And I'm going to go with a 0.25 watt. And I think the other thing I want to make sure is I've selected a metal film as a nice stable type. And there may be something here for selecting an axial package, which is what I'm going to want. And go through here and apply my filters. Yeah, that's working really good. Not letting me apply my filters. Please adjust your reset selected filters so results can be returned. Jeez. Okay, I'm not going to go that way. Okay, back to 18 ohms again here. They could make it a lot easier. Eighteen ohms, 1%, 0.25 watt, metal film. Axial package. Now will it let me apply the filters? It will. Let's see, this guy here looks pretty good. Either of these actually do. S18CACTND. It's a, let's pull that guy up. Pull up the data sheet on it. Looks like a pretty conventional part. Metal film. Make you dig around here to try to find this stuff, but this is the RNMF 14. What's the difference here? RNMF 14 FTC 18 RO. It's got the same part number. Interesting. Got no idea what the difference is here. It seems like it's exactly the same part, but they've got hugely different prices. Oh, you have to buy 5,000 to get this. Or you need to, 5,000 to get this one. That's no good. It must be packaged on a roll or something. That's on a tape reel. That's the thing. So, let's go to this guy here. Okay, so reviewing. It's an 18 ohm quarter watt 1% axial resistor. It's metal film. Looks like everything's great on that. As I'm building four of these things, I need seven each. That's 28, so I'm going to order 30 of these guys. Add it to my cart. They say if I order 50 of these things, it'll be cheaper. It's only $2.16 the way I'm doing it. But if I order 50 of them, I'm going to get them for $1.98. The question is, do I really need an extra 20 of these resistors? On the other hand, I have depleted my parts drawer of 18 ohm resistors, so maybe I will do that. Then I'll have some left after this project. Alright, so now I've got the four power supplies. I've got the LM317s plus spares from my drawer. I've got 50 of these resistors. I'm going to end up shelling out $50, $60, but that's because I'm building four of these and I'm buying a bunch of extra LM317s. It would be a much more reasonable price if you're just buying enough for one lamp or whatever you're doing. Now I would like to get a heat sink, but I've been searching around with the camera off and I've not found a suitable heat sink to fit inside the LED lamp assembly, so I'm just gonna fabricate something, which is probably a good way if anybody else is gonna follow this procedure. You can whip one up out of aluminum that they sell at the hobby store or the hardware store, and that's the approach I'm going to take for the heatsink. So just for fun, I wanted to do an extra verification that the current regulator was doing its job, and in simplifying back the test circuit to the practical circuit, I still have it running with the 1 ohm resistor, which I'm using for sensing current, And I'm going to short out the 1 ohm resistor here. So I've shorted it and unshorted it several times while I'm talking here, and you can see there's no change in the brightness. So the regulator is keeping the current the same, even with this changing resistance in the circuit. I also have temporarily here, just to treat my LM317 a little nicer, I've got a piece of aluminum foil wrapped around it for a bit of a heat sink. I'm also running it now as a test with the 9-volt power supply that I'd ordered from DigiKey, and it's hooked up here. And you may recall that I mentioned that it was unfortunate that I really wanted about 7 volts going into the current regulator, but the next available voltage, well, the next lowest one was 6, which was too low. The regulator wouldn't regulate at that low a voltage, and the next highest one was 9, which gave me a couple of volts more than I really wanted, and that would make the regulator drop an extra 2 volts and dissipate it as heat, which is undesirable, although I expect I could get rid of that with a heat sink. So here's a little trick that is always handy in these situations. These are regular 1N4004 diodes, which can be obtained anywhere from any, you know, Radio Shack or any electronic supplier. They're probably the most common diode in the world. And this is a family of diodes, including it's the 1N4000 series, so it's 1N4001, 1N4002, etc. I've got 1N4004s here. They all have the same current handling capability. The difference is how much voltage they can take, and I'm only working with a few volts here, so it's not important which of the members of the family I use. Any of them would suffice, but I am using the 4004s here. Now, each of these diodes has about a 0.6 volt, thereabouts 0.7 volt drop across it. So the two diodes together, you know, have a drop in the area of 1.2 volts. So putting them in series between the power supply and the regulator drops about 1.2 volts.